So where do these blood cells come from? Blood cells come from certain sites in the body, and they are derived from stem cells. So if you'll recall, we've mentioned stem cells way back at the beginning of the semester. Stem cells are cells that are special because they have the potential to differentiate into a number of different types of cells. So the process of forming blood cells specifically is called hematopoiesis. Hematopoiesis takes place in the bone marrow of the body. And the stem cells that are present in the bone marrow, they can either form erythrocytes or leukocytes. There's a name for each of those processes separately. If we're forming erythrocytes, the process is called erythropoiesis. If we're forming white blood cells or leukocytes, then that's called leukopoiesis. So anyway, the general term is hematopoiesis or hemopoiesis, to refer to the production of blood cells. So again, the sites, where does this take place? After birth, so if it's before birth, then the liver turns out to be really important. But after birth, where this takes place is primarily in the red bone marrow, which is inside of our long bones. It's inside of actually a lot of the bones in the body. So bones don't just provide support. They don't just allow us to move in conjunction with muscles. They also do this very job of producing all of our blood cells. So the red bone marrow, this is present in our long bones. It's also present in the ribs, in the sternum, in the vertebrae even, in the bodies of the vertebrae, and even in some of the bones of the skull. We've got this blood cell production taking place. Okay, so how many cells is it producing each day? You can see the number here on the slide. Each day, about 5 billion cells are being produced. That's a huge number of cells, right? That many blood cells are produced. Just in terms of the red blood cells, remember they have a finite lifespan. They have to get replaced every 120 days or so. And just to sort of maintain the levels of red blood cells, we're making 2.5 million per second. So it's pretty amazing how quickly this can happen. The lymphoid tissue, okay, it has the important role of finishing the production of lymphocytes. Okay, so cell production is initiated in the red bone marrow. This is where the stem cells are at. This is where hematopoiesis takes place. But then in the case of white blood cells, there's more work to be done still. And so the cells travel over to the lymphoid tissue in order to finish maturing, finish differentiating. Okay, so let's start with erythropoiesis. Let's talk about how red blood cells are formed. So again, our starting site is inside of the red bone marrow, inside of a bone. And there's a chemical that is produced by the kidneys. Erythropoietin, this is something that the kidneys produce specifically when the kidneys detect low oxygen levels. Okay, so if you don't have quite enough red blood cells in your body, you then think like if you exercise, you're going to get really out of breath. Your body is going to be a little bit low in oxygen. The kidneys detect that and they start producing erythropoietin. Erythropoietin then makes its way to the red bone marrow and it promotes the differentiation of a stem cell in the red bone marrow. Okay, so it takes the stem cell, facilitates the differentiation into this pathway that's going to lead to red blood cells. Okay, so erythropoietin, this is something that sometimes people take, they're not supposed to, but sometimes people take this in order to up the production of red blood cells, like in sports. This is considered doping. This is not a good thing, but people have done it. Anyway, taking erythropoietin or EPO, this is something that gives you more energy, right? If you have more red blood cells, then you're going to be able to perform better athletically. So that's something that is checked for in sports. They check to make sure that people haven't been doping with EPO. It's a difficult one to check though, because, right, EPO, this is something that's produced naturally by the kidneys. So how do you differentiate between something that's produced naturally versus not? Sometimes that can be a challenge. So coming back anyway into human physiology, erythropoietin stimulates this pathway, and in the end, what we end up with is a red blood cell. The red blood cells, okay, and we've already talked about their lifespan, in the end they get recycled by the spleen and the liver. Let's talk about the iron in this process a little bit more. So when a red blood cell is being recycled, the iron is harvested from it, and it gets recycled. Okay, so where do we get iron from if we don't have enough from recycled red blood cells? Where do we get additional iron? It comes from the diet, right? We eat things with iron, especially if you are a meat eater, then you are eating iron every time you consume meat. So we get iron in the diet, but there's an interesting sort of situation here with iron that's consumed in the diet. Okay, it's absorbed initially by the cells lining the intestinal tract. And if our bodies need iron, so if we are kind of low in iron, then those cells will transport the iron into the bloodstream. If we don't need iron, so if we already have sufficient amounts, then those cells lining the intestine, they just kind of hold on to the iron. They sort of just soak it up. They act like sponges. So the interesting thing is that the only way for our bodies to get rid of extra iron is to literally lose those cells. We have to shed those cells that were holding on to the iron. And we don't have another mechanism in place to just to get rid of excess iron other than shedding those cells. So anyway, there you have it. The pores, the channels that allow transport of iron into the bloodstream are called ferroportin. They transport iron into the blood. And the production of those channels is controlled by a hormone that's produced by the liver. This is getting very complex, but hepcidin is the hormone that the liver produces, and that controls the production and degradation of these ferroportin channels.